Okay, so we're diving into the world of lipoprotein A today. Ever heard of it?
It's not exactly a household name.
Not at all, but it's got this catchy nickname, LPA, and apparently it's a pretty big deal for heart health, which is why we're doing a deep dive right here. But
Right.
let's break it down. First things first, what is lipoprotein? Is it like a rogue cholesterol molecule?
Kind of. Think of it like this. You've got your LDL cholesterol, the bad cholesterol.
Everyone's familiar with that one.
LPA is similar, but it's got this extra little something that makes it even stickier.
Sticky, like literally sticky.
Literally. The Lancet Review used this great analogy. Imagine LDL cholesterol as a smooth, round ball. LPA is the same, but with this extra bit attached to it, almost like a sticky note on a ball.
Okay, now I'm picturing cholesterol with a post-it note stuck to it. Not a good look.
Exactly. And to make it even weirder, this sticky bit is made up of these things called kringles.
Kringles, like the pastry.
Yep, definitely not something you want hanging out in your arteries. But these kringles make LPA really good at latching onto any damage in your blood vessels. And that's where the trouble starts.
So, not as tasty as actual Kringles then. Okay, so this LPA sounds pretty sneaky. How do we even get high LPA in the first place? Is it the usual suspects like a bad diet or not exercising enough?
Here's the thing about LPA. It's mostly determined by your genes. You're born with a certain level, and it tends to stay fairly consistent throughout your life.
So, unlike those extra pounds I put on during the holidays, there's not much I can do about my LPA levels.
Well, lifestyle changes are always a good idea. But you're right, you can't really diet and exercise your way out of high LPA. It's more about knowing your risk and what you can do to manage it. Which brings us to the big question: how worried should people be about their LPA? Should we all be digging through our family trees right now?
Yeah, you mentioned it's genetic, so family history must play a role, right?
Definitely. The Lancet Review actually had this chart showing average LP levels for different ethnicities, and there's definitely some variation.
So, are some ethnicities more prone to high LPA than others?
Well, while average levels might differ between ethnicities, here's the important part. The risk associated with a specific LPA concentration is similar across the board.
So, a high number means high risk, no matter your background.
Exactly. The National Lipid Association update is very clear on this. Above 50 milligram DL, that's considered high risk for everyone.
Good to know. So, no need to calculate your risk based on your great-grandmother's heritage.
Not really, though it is worth noting that women tend to see a rise in LPA after menopause.
Ah, the joys of aging. But before I move on, I have to ask, isn't inflammation a big deal when it comes to heart health? Does LPA factor into that at all?
That's a common misconception. LPA itself isn't directly causing the kind of inflammation that, say, a C-reactive protein test would measure. It's not like it's going around actively making things inflamed.
So, if it's not about inflammation, how does this sticky little molecule actually damage our arteries? Give us the nitty-gritty details.
Think of it this way. Your arteries are like highways.
Okay, I like where this is going.
And plaque buildup is like a traffic jam on those highways. Now, imagine a truck full of gasoline crashing into that traffic jam.
No, that's not good.
That's what high LPA does. It makes those plaque ruptures way more likely, increasing your risk of a major blockage.
So it's not just about the buildup, but about making the consequences so much worse.
Exactly. And as if that wasn't enough, high LPA also contributes to the narrowing of your arteries over time. Imagine it like slowly building a dam in a river. It's going to make it harder for the water to flow through.
And in this case, the water is our blood, which is not a good thing.
Right. And this is especially true when it comes to a condition called aortic valve stenosis.
Aortic valve stenosis. That sounds serious. Tell me more about that.
It is serious. It's like this. Your aortic valve is like a door controlling blood flow from your heart.
Okay, I'm picturing it.
Aortic valve stenosis is when that door gets all stiff and narrow, making it harder for your heart to pump blood effectively. And guess what can make that happen?
Don't tell me. LPA.
You got it. High LPA can contribute to this whole process.
Wow. Okay, so we're not just talking about heart attacks here. This is like a whole other level of heart trouble. And to think people might have high LPA and not even know it.
That's the scary part. If you've got a family history of heart stents, valve issues, early heart attacks, it's really worth getting your LPA levels checked.
This is a lot to take in. We've talked about what LPA is, how it causes all this mayhem in our arteries, how to know if we're at risk. But the million-dollar question is, what can we actually do about it? Is there like a magic pill for high LPA?
I wish. Unfortunately, no magic bullet just yet. But there are things you can do to manage your risk. and some exciting treatments in development, too.
Okay, well, let's start with the good news first. What can people do right now, today, to take control, even with high LPA?
Both the Lancet Review and the National Lipid Association, they were very clear. Aggressive lifestyle changes are key. Even if they don't drastically lower your LPA, they slash your overall risk.
So the usual suspects, eating healthy, exercising, all that good stuff.
Exactly. Might seem basic, but it makes a world of difference. And then on the medication side, getting your LDL cholesterol in check is huge, GE.
Wait, so even though LPA is its own thing, managing our regular old LDL still helps?
Big time. Remember, both of them contribute to that plaque buildup. The NLA update even had something interesting to say about statins.
Oh, statins. I know lots of folks who are on those.
Right. They're still the go-to for lowering LDL. But they might actually bump up LPA a tiny bit for some people.
Hold on. That doesn't sound good.
Don't panic. The increase is usually small. And the benefits of statins, lowering your risk for heart attack and stroke, those far outweigh any small bump in LPA.
So statins are still our friends, even if they're not perfect.
Exactly. It's all about that risk-benefit balance. And for most, statins are a no-brainer.
Makes sense. Now, what about those other cholesterol-lowering meds I've been hearing about? The PCSK9 inhibitors. Could those be helpful here?
You're on top of it.
Yeah.
Those are a newer type of drug, and they can lower both LDL and DLPA. The NLA update specifically called them out as an option for people with what they call residual risk.
Residual risk? That sounds ominous. What is that?
Basically, it means that even after you've done the statin thing, your LDL is still too high. You need extra help to get it down. That's where PCSK9 inhibitors come in. They work totally differently than statins and can give you that extra boost.
So it's like a double whammy against multiple risk factors. I like it. Are there any other options out there right now, especially for people with like really high LPA?
For the really tough cases, there's a procedure called lipoprotein apheresis.
That sounds intense.
It's kind of like dialysis, but instead of filtering out waste products, it specifically removes LPA from your blood. Both the Lancet Review and the NLA update mentioned it. It's not a first-line treatment, though.
I can imagine. Probably not something you'd want to do every week unless you absolutely had to.
Exactly. It involves regular hospital visits, can be time-consuming, expensive.
Yeah.
So yeah, usually reserved for the most severe cases, folks who haven't had success with other treatments.
That makes sense. You did mention new treatments on the horizon, though, which honestly gives me hope. What can you tell us about those?
Oh, there's some cool stuff brewing. Several new drugs in development, targeting LPA in completely new ways. The Lancet Review had this awesome diagram showing all the different types, like a battle plan.
A battle plan against LPA.
Yeah.
I love it. So what are some of the approaches they're exploring?
Some of these drugs are going for a gene silencing approach.
Whoa, gene silencing, like straight out of science fiction.
Right. It's like they're telling your body, hey, stop making so much of that sticky part of LPA.
So a genetic intervention to nip the problem in the bud, that's amazing.
It is. And then there are other drugs aiming to block the formation of LPA altogether, cutting it off at the source, basically.
So different strategies, same goal, less sticky LPA, less heart trouble. What's the timeline looking like for these new treatments? Give me some good news.
The good news is large-scale trials are already happening. For many of these drugs, we're expecting to see results within the next few years. This isn't just a pipe dream anymore. Real potential for some big breakthroughs soon.
That's incredible. Seriously encouraging news for people who've been dealing with high LPA. But with these new treatments potentially around the corner, it seems like accurate LPA testing is going to be even more important, right?
100%. Once we have these targeted therapies, knowing your exact LPA level, that's going to be crucial. It'll help doctors personalize treatment plans, make sure people are getting the most effective care.
This is all such important information. I have to admit, though, it's also a lot to process. Part of me wants to run out and demand a blood test, like right now.
I hear you. It can feel overwhelming.
Yeah.
But honestly, you don't need to become a medical expert overnight.
So what's the most important thing you want listeners to take away from all of this today?
Honestly? Don't panic. This isn't about freaking everyone out.
Right. Good point. Knowledge is power, not a reason to stress.
Exactly. The key takeaway here is awareness. You know more about LPA now, and that means you can have informed conversations with your doctor.
So not necessarily racing off to the doctor demanding a test right this second.
Unless you've got a burning reason, your next checkup is a great time to bring it up. Especially, you know, if heart disease runs in your family, if you're already working on your cholesterol.
Being proactive, I like it. And the NLA update did mention something interesting about LPA testing, something about only needing it once.
Yeah, for most folks, a single measurement is enough. Because remember, those levels, they tend to stay pretty stable over time.
So one and done, that almost seems too easy.
Well, it does make things simpler. But they did say that's a general guideline. Your doctor might want to check more often, depending on your situation, you know.
Which brings us back to advocating for yourself. If you feel like you need more info, more frequent testing, don't be shy. Speak up.
100%. And honestly, what we've talked about today, this is just the tip of the iceberg. There's so much research going on. It's really an exciting time.
And hopefully, by the time we circle back to this topic, even more breakthroughs to talk about. But for now, we've got tons of links in the show notes so folks can dig deeper into the research if they'd like.
Definitely. And remember, knowledge is power. But it's also about having those conversations with your doctor, finding what's right for you.
Couldn't agree more. All right, that's a wrap for today's deep dive into the wild world of LPA. Until next time, folks, stay curious and stay healthy. Okay, so we're diving into the world of lipoprotein A today. Ever heard of it?
It's not exactly a household name.
Not at all, but it's got this catchy...